21st episode of the Brew Crew Review, your favorite source of baseball news and inspired winter baseball talk. We're here with our favorite panelists and missing one as well. But over on the other side here is the great Chad Collins.
Hello, West Dallas, hello, Wisconsin.
It's always good to have you here, Chad. And to my direct right is our executive producer, the one and only Mr. Craig Mueller. Craig? Glad to see you here on the set again today.
Well, sir, what a happy holidays. Hopefully all you viewers out there will check out our Christmas special, which was absurd and ridiculous, but we did get through that. And of course, we're here to talk about the baseball winter meetings have gone on since our last taping. And of course, the Brewers did make some moves during this year's winter meetings. And so we've got some exciting stuff to talk about as our the 2006 Milwaukee Brewers are starting to form. It's starting to take shape. So I think the big question came in the offseason was, what were the Brewers going to do with first baseman Lyle Overbay? Prince Fielder, of course, one of our top prospects, ready, spent half the year at AAA last year and spent some time in the majors as well. And he's definitely ready for a major league job, as most people within the organization thought. So the question was, what do you do with fan favorite first baseman Lyle Overbay? He's only been with the club 2 years since he came over in the Richie Second trade with Arizona. In his first year, 2004, he broke the Brewers' single-season record for doubles that was owned by, former Brewer and now bench coach Robin Yount. And he was also a solid middle-order hitter for us last year as well, and also a fan favorite, as people know, that he has his own O chant and just a great guy. So
yeah, had his own O chant.
Yeah,
not anymore fans. Sorry.
Well, so I think coming in the offseason, people were wondering, well, what is general manager Doug Melvin going to do with them? Both him and the owner Atanasio kind of said that there was a possibility, that a pretty good possibility, that maybe Overbay would be back and that Fielder could use some more seasoning, or maybe we'd wait to the trade deadline to trade Overbay. But I think what happened is we did trade Overbay. What do you guys take on both Melvin and Antonio's position? On the, at first they said 90% Lyle would be back, and it went down to closer to about 50% they'd be back before he did actually get traded. What did you guys think about that? Were they serious about keeping Lyle, and they were just only going to trade him if the right deal came along? Or do you think the plan was all along to definitely trade him this offseason?
I think that I agree with Melvin. I think that he did want to keep Overbay. I think he also wanted to keep him too, just as a good insurance policy for Prince. And I really believe in their heart of hearts they wanted Lyle on the team because he brought a lot to the team, as well as he brought a legion of fans to Miller Park as well. But I think the right deal did come along. I'm very satisfied with the deal. I know we'll talk a little bit more about it as the show goes along. But I think it was the right move for the team. So unfortunately, I guess it was Lyle's time to go. But I think they did want to keep him, but the trade was too good. They had to move him on. So
yeah. So, do you have any other things?
Well, I agree with you, Chad, and I think that there was, the necessity of moving him at this point, both for the Brewers and for Lyle as a first baseman as well. He just wasn't going to be able to stay on our team. Doug Melvin perhaps had been saying some of these percentages, I think, as kind of perhaps a bit of a feint, you could say, so that other GMs wouldn't think that they could take advantage of the Brewers with the trade. And like we had discussed on our last show, the Christmas episode, before we got to the caroling portion of the show, which was
we do apologize for
ridiculous.
That
I'm sorry, Wisconsin.
It,
but In any case, I think that we had talked about the percentages that he kept giving, and I think that he was going to be giving Overbay in a trade only if we could get a deal that the Brewers really wanted. It would really help our team. I don't think he was going to do a trade just to make a trade. But at the same time, I think that if there was one that presented itself, like it did with Toronto, that he was definitely going to take it and was looking for that deal right now. So,
yeah. So let's go over the details of that trade that was made on just after 11 p.m. Central Time. Of course, on Wednesday, December 7th, 2005.
A date which will possible, live in infamy.
A possible red-letter date for the future of the Brewers organization, in my opinion.
10:17 Eastern Standard Time.
Yeah. The date which will live in infamy.
Yep, exactly. But anyway, the details of that trade, of course, the Brewers sent first baseman Lyle Overbay and also double-A pitcher Ty Tobenheim to the Toronto Blue Jays in exchange for starting pitcher Dave Bush, also top pitching prospect, left-hander Zach Jackson, and additionally outfielder Gabe Gross. Now, both Jackson and Gabe Gross were former number one draft picks from the Blue Jays organization, and Dave Bush was a second-round draft pick. So these were all highly touted guys coming in, coming into the draft, and they've had, you know, up and down success, but I think the key point is all these guys are young guys that have their the best days and their futures ahead of them, and I think really fits into the mold that the Brewers are filling as a team. Dave Bush is 26, Gabe Gross also 26, and Zach Jackson's turning 23, I believe. So, so a bunch of young guys. What did you guys think about this trade? I don't know who wants to start this off. Was this the trade that you were hoping for? I know that a lot of fans were talking about there was some speculation that one of the only other teams interested in Overbay at the time of the winter meetings there was the Boston Red Sox. And they were possibly offering us Matt Clement. And it was also rumored that they offered us Bronson Arroyo. Whether or not they offered us any prospects as well, we don't know. But
I think the key to that trade, too, is the fact that Boston was not going to be willing to pick up any of Clement's salary if he was traded to Milwaukee. There was some various rumors about that, but it was reported, I think, 2 days later in the Journal Sentinel by our good friend and colleague Tom Hodricourt that the Red Sox were not going to actually be willing to pick up any of Clement's salary, and so thus we were going to be stuck with a $9 million a year pitcher for the next 2 years. So it's up to the Brewers if they want to invest that kind of money in a guy like Clement, whose ERA is so-so and who's had some success in the National League Central, but last year wasn't playing as well and had been hurt for a while, too. So it's Clement's obviously a great pitcher, but at the same time, if we're able to get a couple prospects as pitchers and then another position player that we could either use or trade, I think that Doug Melvin had a great moment at the winter meetings in Texas and pulled off a good trade with Toronto.
Yeah,
I was pretty concerned, actually, because just the way things were going, Delgado signed with the Mets, so that was one team that was eliminated. The White Sox were eliminated with Tome and Canerico. So I kind of thought that Melvin's options were a little dwindled. So actually, I was pretty satisfied with the trade. I think we got a lot more than what I thought we could get. As much as we love Lyle Overbay on the show, in all honesty, he is a little above average. Probably a poor man's Mark Grace, definitely not the power numbers for a first baseman, average glove. So I think just for basically a little above average first baseman, I think we got a really good deal. I mean, we got a starting pitcher who is what we needed. We were looking for that. We got a starting pitcher whose numbers are basically the same as Clement's and a lot cheaper, a lot more upside, hopefully. And then we got a nice prospect who was highly touted, and then maybe another fifth outfielder. So we'll see what happens. I think Melvin got a lot more than what I expected him to get. So I was pretty satisfied with the trade, especially with the number of teams that were kind of dwindling filling the first basemans.
Right.
Position, so I was pretty satisfied with what happened.
And Toronto went after Overbay pretty hard. I mean, they had been talking about him since the beginning of the offseason. They said that they needed this bat, but it wasn't ever sure that they would really follow through because it seemed like after the offseason kind of went on a little bit that they were actually looking for another power bat. And I know right now Toronto is, as of this taping, is talking about picking up Milton Bradley. There's been some other names that are surfacing there that they might still try to pick up to add that additional bat. But Overbay doesn't provide the kind of power that they were always looking for. He does provide, a solid bat. I think you said it before, he plays good defense, but not completely gold glove style defense either. But they're getting a solid player in Lyle Overbay. I think that Toronto's going to benefit from this too, just because of the style of team that they have. But we'll see what happens. I think both teams are going to end up benefiting from this, but they should know that he's not the power-hitting first baseman that they originally been talking about this offseason.
There was also another rumor going around before this trade actually went through with these players that the offer on the table was Dave Bush and Shea Hillenbrand. Obviously, the Blue Jays have a logjam of first base, third base types with Eric Hinsky, Shea Hillenbrand now acquiring Overbay. That made more sense to me that might be happening because of the fact that they needed to get rid of one of those guys anyway. You know, Hinsky's an actual native of Wisconsin, but really he doesn't have much upside from here. Hillenbrand might have been a decent player, but he also is making $4.5 million, I believe, next year, so which would have been a little bit more than Overbay was even making. Some people were calling him, well, he's the same, similar type of player as Overbay, but he's instead right-handed, and he's got more flexibility. He can play first, third, in the outfield. He could have maybe platooned or, you know, filled in if Prince doesn't make it. I personally was really glad that we did not acquire him because I don't feel he's the player that we really needed. And even though maybe we could have turned him off and traded him again for maybe some other, I'm happy with the players we did get. What did you guys think about that rumor?
Yeah, I was kind of concerned about that rumor too. I got this TC.
Tom Carter.
Just call him TC.
Anonymous.
Then they won't talk
anonymous
to him.
Source. Yeah.
Unidentified. But anyways, our source TC, Tom.
Told
us that Hillenbrand was going to be involved in the trade, but thankfully it didn't happen. And I was happy about that. And that's a good point you bring that up because I think it shows a lot of faith in Bill Hall. Doug Melvin and Eddie Olson think about Bill Hall and that he is our third baseman. And I just think if they would have brought Hillenbrand over, that would have cast a doubt upon Hall, maybe hurt his confidence a little. I think Bill Hall has earned a position. I'm kind of excited to see what he's going to do with it on a 162-game basis. And I think he doesn't have to worry about a Hillenbrand around the corner or anyone else like that. I think the job's his. And I think it was good that they didn't pick him. It's just a show of faith and a show of confidence to see what he can do. So I was pretty happy we didn't get him involved in that trade.
Yeah, I agree with you. I can't think of a position that we might not need to fill more than the bullpen or instead of third base. So to get these extra pitchers, you know, I think was a lot better for the Brewers in the long term.
And we got Cirillo there, too.
We have Cirillo.
Yeah.
As of this taping, we still have Russell Branyon,
yeah.
But hopefully he's traded in the next week.
So. Yeah. So, I mean, I think it was a brilliant move. I mean, I was borderline ecstatic about the trade myself. And some people might not understand this, but I really do think that not only will Dave Bush be a better pitcher than Matt Clement, but I think he almost is to that stage already. And this is even before he's ever experienced the Maddox touch. So that happens,
that's
I think this
is right.
There's
the
only.
How is that going for you, by the way?
You know,
I
went to the cages a few days ago, and they had a couple guys who were just taking some cuts in this batting cage. And, you know, I said, you know, I can throw a little BP and see what happens here. I hadn't thrown for a while. It had been since our season last summer. But, I got back in the cages. And, you know, last summer I think I was throwing about 75, if that. I was lucky to hit that on the gun and going really downhill since my days in high school. But I was facing this guy in the cage, and I went back and I threw. And honest to God, the thing came back, and it was 93 miles an hour on the gun. So Mike Maddox, by touching my shoulders, perhaps propelled me to become a Brewers pitching prospect.
We're really hoping we don't.
Future, the music, and you can hear the music right now, actually. And,
yeah.
It's there, and I'm hoping for a Rookie of the Year type.
We're kind of pulling for you here as your friends and co-hosts to make that roster or to make it with your newfound glory of your arm, but I really think that would be a huge loss to the show here if you were to actually.
Well, I tell you what, if I did make it to the Brewers, I'd still grant you guys at least an interview, a half season. So Mike Maddox's touch is going to be huge for Dave Bush and for Zach Jackson and for even Gabe Gross. I mean, as an outfielder, you need an arm.
And speaking of that, I think Gabe Gross supposedly has a pretty decent outfield arm. So he's a right-handed throwing outfielder, and he bats left-handed. So let's kind of break down these players a little bit more. We'll end this segment by having a special tribute to our good friend and Lyle Overbay with a little video segment here at the end of this trade talk.
He was one of the
talk,
original members of the show, one of our first interviews.
Team Brew Crew Review.
Brew Crew Review, DVD copy, if Craig just wants to run the footage again. Of
he threw us
balls,
a ball tonight. That's part of the video collage.
But the effort was there, he thought about it.
Yeah,
so.
The effort was there, and he enjoyed that DVD copy that we gave to him.
Mm-hmm.
But he was always a big fan of our show, and we always appreciate it.
Usually when you trade a player, and you trade a player and you want the Brewers to get the best on deals, so you kind of root against that player possibly. But not, I think, in this case, not only us, but all Brewer fans, I think, are going to be pulling for Lyle. Definitely. He's like the type of guy you just can't root against. I mean, he's a great team player. He's unassuming type of guy. He's really humble, and I think he was almost humbled and somewhat embarrassed about this call. Chant they had. I think he just thought that was so much, and I think he really appreciated more than any other player really would. So
that's not mentioning what a class act he was. I mean, when they had that winter program on FSN with their good friend Darren Sutton, Lyle Overbay was there. I mean, he didn't have to be there. He probably knew he was going to get traded, but he was still there to help out the Brewers and model off some new uniforms and fashion wear. So I thought that was a pretty classy move on him. Most players, if they were on the edge, wouldn't have to come down there in their off season, but he took the time to come down and still show some loyalty to the organization. So he's a class act. I appreciated him.
And actually, one of the interviews that he gave in the paper the day or two after he was traded, they asked him about what he thought about Toronto as a city, and he said that the only time he'd ever been there was actually when he was there with the Brewers this past summer. And so, of course,
that's the only time we've been there too.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Another similarity between us and Lyle Overbay. Lyle, glad that you had a good vacation with us, and you know, hopefully, you enjoy Toronto a little bit more this summer. But it was a good point I think that he made, and I hope that he has a great career in Toronto and propels the Blue Jays to third place in that division.
And what's nice is he's not even in our division, he's not even in our league, so we can reform him and not have to suffer any kind of consequence.
I want to really kind of try to introduce some of the players we got to the Brewers, because I think the casual fans' reaction to this trade is probably negative for the fact that they haven't heard of these guys we acquired. So to the casual fan, they just view it as trading off another player for scraps.
Look at how many casual fans said they would boycott the Brewers after Sexton got traded. And Sexton, within a year.
The whole Sexton trade breakdown and going over the branches that have like really helped fill holes throughout the organization, I think has set us up to become contenders for the next 3 to 5 years, hopefully, is really important. So
players are now from the Sexton trade. Lyle Overbay, who we acquired for Sexton. We still have Tomooka, who we traded for Junior Spivey.
Three-fifths of our rotation is from.
But anyway, let's save this for another show, guys, because we'll go in-depth. Actually, we'll date it all the way back to how Bob Wickman helped restock the Brewers organization. We'll have that in maybe January or February 2006, so watch for that show.
And hopefully an interview with Bob Wickman. I know he still lives in the area, just recently re-signed with Cleveland as their closer again for next season, even though Indians actually tried to sign two other closers besides that.
Well, did a phenomenal job last
year. Trevor Hoffman. But in any case, Bob, we still love you here in Milwaukee for what you've done for us.
We'll just hope Scott's here, and then we'll worry about Bob Wickman.
Yeah, definitely. As soon as we find our own hosts, then we'll be able to bring you Bob Wickman.
Okay, well, without further ado, let's get more into the players that we acquired. I'd say the centerpiece, as it stands right now, of the trade is starting with Dave Bush. Here's a guy who, like I said, was drafted in the second round of 2001 by the Toronto Blue Jays. He, in his rookie year, 2 years ago in 2004, he pitched the last 2 months of the season, I believe, as a Blue Jay. And he pitched really well, and I think he showed a lot of potential and upside as a right-handed pitcher. And I remember reading last spring, coming out of spring training in Sports Weekly, I believe it was, that the manager of the Blue Jays really talked highly of Dave Bush. He said he had the type of competitor, bulldog mentality that you rarely see in a young pitcher. And I think, to me, that's why if for people that don't like, okay, well, who is this guy we got and who can we compare him to? If as a Brewer fan, as a casual Brewer fan, if you want to know who, in my opinion, you can probably compare him to, is a right-handed version of possibly someone like Chris Capuano. And with that same type of potential as a 2 or 3 starter, if he's able to fulfill that. And we all know with the Maddox touch that hopefully we'll be able to. But last year he struggled a little bit, but I mean, I think as a young pitcher, you go through those growing pains. Capuano did the same thing, struggling with command and with health problems. But I think once he ties it all together, and hopefully it's starting this year under the tutelage of Maddox and the Brewer, in the Brewers' rotation, you can plug him in right away as a 4th or 5th starter. And I know people have said, well, is he going to have to compete with Rick Helling for the job? I should hope not. I mean, of course, it'll be open competition, but
Rick Helling is going to be, our
long reliever or spot starter.
The Dave Burba.
And it's actually really valuable to have a somewhat solid 6th starter because
someone's gonna go down.
Traditionally, the 6th starter on teams usually pick up between 20 and 30 starts a year. Right. So to have a valuable guy at that position with that depth is great.
And additionally, he's a guy who's got some, you know, veteran experience.
Yeah.
He's been around the league forever. He's going to be able to give guys like Dave Bush
yeah.
and some of our younger pitchers hopefully some tutelage and some knowledge besides Mike Maddox. And, you know, as much as you listen to a coach, I think many times as a young player, you're more inclined to listen to a fellow player. And if Maddox can relay a message through Helling to a younger pitcher, well, then the better for the entire organization. So
yeah.
To me, I think that's a great move. And also, I like the point that you made, executive producer Mueller, about his attitude and his competitiveness, that when he's playing, he's known as kind of a bulldog type. That's exactly what I think Doug Melvin and Gord Ash both said in quotes this week. And I think that's huge because the Brewers need guys like that. We're going to have times that the Brewers are not going to have, talent-wise, necessarily the best team on the field, even though we're a young and up-and-coming team. There still are a lot of teams with a lot of veteran players and a lot of experience and playoff experience and everything else. But when we have that kind of attitude, I think that we stay in games longer. We can keep ourselves competitive, and I think we're going to win a lot more games by having those types of guys
yeah.
than having an overpaid veteran pitcher here who just doesn't really want to be here, doesn't think that this team is on the rise, doesn't see the value in the young players, somebody like A.J. Burnett or pick your free agent that was out there this offseason.
Yeah.
Another nice thing, too, about Bush is, like, his stats were pretty impressive. I mean, considering the division he plays in, I mean, with the balanced schedule, I mean, he's probably going against a division that has the best offense ever when you have the Yankees and Red Sox,
right.
Baltimore, even Tampa Bay would put up
that's
a lot
right.
of runs on the scoreboard. So I think he has the experience. He's played against a lot of good teams. In hostile situations, I think it's going to be a great pick.
And I believe he's had 41 career starts over the year and a half he's been in the majors, and I believe his ERA is just a little bit over four. So
yeah.
I really think that, and hopefully that's Scotty calling because my cell phone's buzzing in my pocket here, so maybe we'll finally find the whereabouts. With that great Christmas gift you gave him, maybe someone's finally calling it. Hopefully he's not ending up in a ditch. I'll have to check that when I take a break.
Speaking
here.
Of Christmas gifts, did we mail that baloney to... Mark,
the private detective.
Yeah, I don't know. Hopefully, you got that before Christmas.
We mail it to him at his private detective agency on Forest Home Avenue, which we can't tell him.
Yeah,
where
we
that
can't
is, but
tell you the whereabouts.
Yeah, somewhere between 40th and 50th Street.
Yeah, you can just MapQuest it. But
anyway, getting back to Dave Bush, he's someone I think to really look. I expect him to in his prime, which should be in the next couple of years. Win between 13 and 16 games a year, and I think he can have a 3.5 ERA. This next season, I expect him to have right under a 4 ERA and win anywhere from 10 to 12 games. And as a four starter, that's someone pretty reliable that I think the Brewers can count on.
Right.
And not only that, he has upside, more so than Clement, who I think is in his prime. And not only that, but he's just so much cheaper. Like Clement was under contract for two more years at $9.5 million each.
And it's not just a matter of saving the money, it's spending the money wisely. Because
yeah.
now we get three players, we save salary, and then we can use that money and invest it in another player
at
some
really
point down the line, whether this
offseason
in a trade or next offseason or in an extension for Carlos Lee or whoever
such
it might
great,
be.
Such great
exactly.
flexibility.
And not to interrupt you, but one more thing I wanted to get back a little bit to what Chad said before in talking about the competition. His competition wasn't just the AL East, but the entire American League. It's an offensive league, and he's playing against a lot of teams that are offensively incredibly capable.
Pitchers will be batting now.
And pitchers will be batting now. And you compare his numbers to Matt Clement's numbers, who, when he was with the Cubs in the National League, and even if they're fairly similar, you take, I think, Bush's numbers with Toronto down quite a bit more than you would, bring Clement's up because his switching of league. So I think that's another factor to look at when you compare Bush to Clement.
And I think another factor is that he's not eligible to become a free agent now until 2009, and so he's going to be cheap and have potential, and hopefully be a staple at some position in our rotation for the next 4 years, if not, or whatever. So, I mean, that's exciting to think about. So there's always that possibility that he could not fulfill his potential, have health problems, be a bust. There's always that potential, but really from what I've read and heard about the guy, I think that under the right, I think he's on the right track, and that hopefully he'll get on that track with the Milwaukee Brewers. So anyway, getting on to the other player we acquired in the trade, and that's Zach Jackson. This is a 2004 supplemental first-round draft pick by the Blue Jays. Now, here's a guy who went through three levels in the minor leagues in his first professional season in the minors. He started off at single A and dominated. I think, I believe, it was 8-1. Then he got moved up to double A, and of course, like any young pitcher will do, it was not quite as successful there. And then triple A, he got moved up to because I think of some injuries. So he kind of got rushed through the system in his first year. And he struggled a little bit more there. But overall, I believe he won 16 games in the minor leagues in his first professional season. And that's pretty quality from a guy. And this is a guy who, from what I understand, was the second best left-hander coming out of college, available in the draft in 2004. So I don't think this is a guy that the Blue Jays gave up on to trade us. I think the only reason that he was included in the trade is because I think Melvin demanded a top pitching prospect. And the Blue Jays, not only signing Burnett, have that flexibility. They also, their minor leagues is stocked with a bunch of top minor league. Right, they've got David Percy, who was also drafted the first round of that year by them. They've got Josh Banks. They've got Dustin McCowan, who was I believe 2003 number one draft pick by them, who's got even a higher ceiling. Yes. So they've got all these top pitching prospects. I really, give kudos to Melvin for demanding that one of those prospects be included in a trade with us. If they really wanted Orbe, which from what I understand they did, that they needed to include them. So that's why I'm much, much more happy with that over someone like Shea Hillenbrand being part of the deal. So here's a guy who I think will spend all of 2006 season probably at AAA, and we'll see, what happens 2007, if he's ready to be part of our rotation or even in the bullpen. I believe the plan is to keep him as a starter. But here's a guy with a pretty big upside. I think that he's got a ceiling as a number two starter, and that's something pretty exciting, especially with the Brewers not having very much success on drafting pitchers out of high school or college recently, with injuries mostly to the likes of Mike Jones,
Manny Parra,
Nick Neugenbauer, Mark Rogers also struggled out of high school in his first season, but I think he still has a promising future. But I think here's a guy that's more major league ready than any other of our pitchers. Maybe I'd put him on par with Dana Evelyn as far as being ready for the major leagues. Dana Evelyn, I believe, will go on that same track and probably start 2006 back at AAA.
And I think that depends a bit about the market, too, with Evelyn, not to get off topic here. But yeah. Evelyn is going to, I think, actually be given a chance to win a spot in our bullpen as a lefty unless we get somebody in a trade or via free agency. It depends, I think, what we do in the brand new.
We didn't have any lefties in our bullpen. Yeah. And it's hard with pitching prospects. I mean, not everyone can be like a Tim Dillard that, just comes out of the 34th round and just dominate. I mean, I don't know. It's hard. But at least we got an established prospect and – I don't know. I like the trade.
Again. Yeah, and also the throw-in, the quote-unquote throw-in of the trade then was our third player we acquired, and that's Gabe Gross. Now, Gabe Gross is a former number one pick as well. I believe he was number one pick of the Blue Jays in 2001. He was the 15th overall selection out of Auburn, and he was very touted coming out of one of the best college hitters coming out of Auburn. He's really not necessarily struggled in the minors, but I don't think his power potential has been there to be a corner outfielder. I know that he actually led the major leagues during last year's spring training with 8 dingers. So I think he's got the potential, if he fulfills it, that he can hit 20 to 25 homers given a starting job and probably hit 280 with great defense. So I would put him on par just, to help out Brewer fans to at least know, how good of his potential he has. I'd put it on par with, what a Nelson Cruz. Maybe not quite as high as Corey Hart, but, Nelson Cruz as far as the fact that they're both 26 now, Cruz and Gabe Gross. The other key thing that Gabe Gross is a left-handed hitter, and I think that he doesn't need to spend any more time in the minor leagues. He spent all last year at AAA. Like Hart, I think he's going to be in our outfield mix as far as backing up, being our fourth and fifth outfielder. And with the trade of Overbay, it really only leaves two guys on our 25-man roster, that being Prince Fielder and Jeff Jenkins as our left-handed hitter. So by, I think Zach Zorensen, who's another utility infielder we signed, is also a switch hitter. But it also
Capuano is a left-handed hitter.
Yeah, but a pitcher. But yeah, that's true, and he's a damn good one at that. But anyway, what I was gonna say is Gabe Gross, I think by acquiring him and just throwing him in there as our fifth outfielder with some upside, also now fills another need, and that was a left-handed bat off the bench. So Melvin doesn't have to sign anyone now. Filled holes.
Do you think that the Gabe Gross acquisition is the final nail in the coffin for Dave Krenzel and the Brewer organization?
That's a good point.
It's tough to say, but here's an exciting thing to think about. Not only did this trade not tie any more finances into us for the future, which really gives us tons of flexibility going into the trade deadline and next offseason. So next offseason's free agent market will be a better, and the Brewers can just fill in whatever need they by signing someone they need, and that's exciting. And not only that, but if, let's say we're contending, and that's, I think, what we're expecting to this point, at this year's trade deadline, the Brewers can be players to acquire someone to improve their team. And the reason they're able to do that is because now we have a glut of outfield prospects that are ready for the major leagues. You know, all these years the Brewers have been trading off their better veteran players for prospects. Now we can turn the tables and take on some salary and take on a better player at the trade deadline, which is exciting because if you think about it, we've got, Lee, Jenkins, Clark pretty solidified in our outfield. So that leaves Hart, Nelson Cruz,
Dave
Kerenzel, who will probably, definitely be back at AAA because he only hit 250 there. But Gabe Gross
and Tony Gwynn Jr.
Tony Gwynn Jr., mm-hmm. who's, down there too. But those four guys, I think, are almost major league ready. And so we can easily spin one or if not two of them off to another team in a trade, someone, who's out of contention, example being the Devil Rays or Pirates or something, and get one of their better pitchers or whatever hole we need to fill at that. So that's exciting that we can add the payroll.
And Chad, to try to directly answer your question a little bit more, I don't think that this necessarily spells the end of the Dave Kerenzel prospect status in Milwaukee, just because they're different types of ball players. I think Kerenzel brings different facets to the game. He's a faster guy. We could even just bring him up to be sort of a pinch runner and occasional bat off the bench type. It all depends. If Kerenzel keeps hitting the way that he is, I can't see him being a real major league outfielder, to be honest with you. But, if we want to bring him up to be, a pinch runner or something off the bench, then perhaps that could still be a reasonable option and
still
not even worry about him playing defense, really.
Still an upgrade over Durington or Magruder.
Yeah,
exactly.
I don't think we should necessarily give up on Dave because he had one off year at AAA. He was on a nice progressive track through the minors all the way up to last season. I think it could just be an off year. And so I still think that he's, besides Brady Clark, the only other legitimate leadoff hitter in our system. So I think he'd actually be the least likely guy to get traded, unless, of course, he struggles the first half, and it's just obvious that this kid needs a change of scenery, and someone else willing to take him on, he might excel. So I think that would be otherwise, it's more likely we trade one of our corner on-field prospects, that being Hart, Cruz, or Gabe Grohl. So, and right now, as we speak, Nelson Cruz is tearing up the Dominican Winter League, I believe. He was leading the league in home runs the last, as of this taping. So, this is really exciting. Yeah, this is really exciting for the Brewers to have this type of depth and flexibility going in the future. So, I think that's why the brilliance of this trade will really not be shown immediately, but like the Sexton trade, as it branches out over the next couple of years, we'll see that, and, how this is really help the Brewers organization. I think it's a brilliant move by Melvin.
And like you alluded to, it's also a move that, if we're really going to look at all the branches of this trade, might have to take into account signing a free agent next offseason.
Yeah.
Because it freed up the money to do that. So.
All right. So great discussion, guys. Let's end this segment, and we'll take a little break, and we'll come back, and we'll discuss the other move the Brewers made in this offseason, and that is the return of former closer Dan Cole back to our bullpen. So we'll take a short break, and we'll be right back here on the Brew Crew Review.
Just have to be the best Lyle Overbay you can be. In other words, just approach hitting as you have your whole life.
Well, that's it. I only wear size 13 shoes. I know Richie's size about 16 or 17, so there's no way I'm going to fill his shoes. But I think we're better off. We got a couple other players to come over and fill some holes and give us some depth. And like I said, I just need to do my game, and hopefully that's good enough. My two goals in every year: drive in runs, drive in at least 100 runs. You always want to get that century mark and hit over 300. And those are attainable goals. And then if you get above those, then you go to the next level. And so those are the only two goals. And then hopefully, I always want to hit over 400 and with runners in scoring position. So that's a big goal because, like I said, you're either driving in runs or you're scoring runs. So I think I'm not the fastest guy, so I need to drive them in. An all-star, you lost your best player, and everybody's been welcoming me and saying you're going to do a good job and really support me. So I'm makes my job a lot easier when I feel wanted. So I appreciate it. I just get a smile on my face every time I get to think that Miller Park's going to be my home field.
What's the biggest adjustment when you're traded to a new city?
Getting to know everybody, I played with Scott Pasednik, or played against him, I played against Keith Ginter, I don't know anybody else. I mean, I know their names, but I don't know how personal they are, and I want to come over and get to know those guys and pick their minds. It's that way we can kind of get going. I mean, I think team chemistry is a big thing in baseball, I mean, any sport really, but and that team chemistry comes with knowing the guys. That's kind of the biggest adjustment there, is just really getting to know those guys, and I'm in a new situation though that I'm excited for, and it's something I've been waiting for a long time, and I just want to take advantage of that.
All right, well, the page is turned in Wisconsin, and I think on the next page we found a quality guy. Let's give a big ovation to Lyle over there.
Not only in the future, but this year alone can finish over, at least 500, if not above.
Absolutely, I think that's the worst case scenario. I think, I mean, we've got experience from last year that we had some tough times, and a lot of these guys, including myself, learned from it. So if we can take that in, and we got good pitching, we got good offense now. I mean, it's consistent throughout the lineup.
And then you're from Nevada originally, is that correct?
I'm from Washington.
Oh, from Washington. Okay.
School.
Oh, in Nevada. Okay, and that's right. And so I've heard rumors that you were known as a Nevada hitting legend. What do you think about your career at Nevada?
It treated me real well, but I had good guys around me to help me out, so it made my job a lot easier.
That's cool. You probably noticed this, that the fans, at least here in Milwaukee, have started a new chant for you when you come up to the plate. And it involves the letter O. Do you know how that came about?
I have no clue. I know the Buckethead Brigade, I think, is what started on Tuesday, and it's just kind of ballooned from there. But I don't know. I don't know where they come up with that. But hey, it's awesome.
Before you enter the batter's box and you hear that, what is it? Does it motivate you, or how does it make you feel up there at the plate?
Absolutely. Sometimes it probably works against me. I get too excited. I want to do, you know, I want to hit the ball, but you know, it's fun. I mean, I love it because the fans are into it. They're excited, and they're having fun.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, Lyle. Good luck with another successful season. Once again, thanks for the interview.
Yeah, no problem.
Thanks. We're back on the Brew Crew Review, and we're going to talk about one of the other moves that was made by the Brewers at the winter meetings, and that was the reacquiring of...
December 6th, 2005.
That's
December
6th.
Do you have a time?
5:13 p.m.
When it went, all went down.
13, yeah.
We completed the official fleecing of the Atlanta Braves by reacquiring Dan Kolb, who we traded in last offseason, you might remember, for one of their top pitching prospects, Jose Capion. And now... we got Cole back, and all it cost us was Wes Obermiller. So if you do the math here, it basically was Wes Obermiller for Jose Capion, and I think that we got the better end of that deal, even though Capion hasn't.
Yeah. Kolb. Yeah.
Yeah, that's all right. No,
Kolb equals... yeah.
We'll do some type of equation on that one.
Yeah.
Anyway, but, all right, so Danny Kolb... came back to the Brewers via trade. We traded Wes Obermiller to get him. Now, are you guys going to miss Wes Obermiller and his potent bat as a pitcher and his not-so-potent arm on the mound? I know he almost threw a no-hitter last year against the Washington Nationals, but overall, this is a guy who just did not fill potential, so I don't think he'll be missed whatsoever.
No,
and maybe he definitely just needed a change of scenery. I wish him the best of luck.
He needed a change of scenery from Kansas City and got one in Milwaukee, and he's going to need a change of scenery in Atlanta, and he's going to get it there, too. He'll probably need a change of scenery again in about a year or so.
Well, he's a good guy. I mean,
yeah, nice guy. Change of scenery in Nashville, too.
Nice guy. Yeah, Nashville is a good change of scenery for him, too. You know, the more times you change the scenery, the more times I think you get traded to different clubs. You get to tour the country, which is nice. But I don't think that we're going to be missing Wes Obermiller too much here in Milwaukee. And great guy, but he wasn't going to be part of our pitching plans, I don't think.
And he kind of filled in as our sixth starter last year, and he didn't do too bad of a job, but obviously he was given all the chances that he could possibly ask for in Milwaukee and didn't necessarily excel, so he never won a spot in our rotation. I don't think his future is that bright, as Vince is probably kind of alluding to in those.
It's kind of like the same thing that that book you gave us for Christmas from that private detective, Mark A.
Oh, and Toniak,
yeah, referring to like
first you got
a bodily excrement, no matter how you wrap it, it still smells the same, so. No matter how the scenery is, probably get the same results.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if Mark had Wes Obermiller in mind when he was penning his book, but
of a Trent Durrington fan.
In any case, it was very worthwhile advice and very sage from Mark. And as always, our private detective Mark Antoniak is always coming through.
Words
of
wisdom.
I don't know if we ever mentioned on the air either that our good friend Mark A. Once predicted that in the 2005 season, Ben Sheets was going to throw at least three 3 to 4 no-hitters.
Yeah, the inside scoop on that one was a bit off. I'm not sure where he came up with those clues.
He was off 3 to 4, but he was close.
Yeah.
But I think what he meant to say is Benji's a quality pitcher, and he expected the best out of him.
Maybe in the course of a career -3, he might be close.
Yeah. It's not bad as a fan of a team to expect the most out of your players. And a couple of no-hitters from Sheets is not necessarily out of the ordinary. But I'd give him a couple of years on that at least. Ben, if you could please, over the next 3 to 5 years, throw at least 1-2 no-hitters, and I'd be very satisfied with that as a Brewer.
Well, we figured this year if he gets 6 to 8 no-hitters, it'll balance out for what he missed last year.
Yeah,
so
that's true.
Six to eight for you this year, Mark.
Six to eight.
Yeah. So, anyway, what do you guys think of the Kolb? The reacquisition of Kolb now gives us legitimate 3 closing prospects or potential closers. Obviously, it's Turnbow's job.
Yep.
And now as setup men, you have Dan Kolb,
Matt Wise,
and Jose Capion.
Possibly Danny Eveland.
And Danny Eveland, possibly in the bullpen. So I think it really helps solidify our bullpen. But not only that, in this day where people are throwing contracts of $8 million plus a year to quality closers, to have such options in case of injury or in case there's always a possibility that possibly Turnbow could revert to not being quite as good as he was last year. I don't foresee that happening, but it's nice to have that depth and insurance by having Kolb back on the team. So now you have, over the last 2 years, Kolb saved 39 games for the Brewers, which was a record 2 years ago.
Yep.
Last year, Turnbow did it. Yep. So here you've got two guys on your team going to 2006 who have saved a combined
78
games for the last for the Milwaukee Brewers the last 2 seasons, so that's exciting. Mm-hmm. And then you have a Capion, who I think could be a very good future closer. So with all these options for our future, I think this was a really good move by the Brewers.
And I'd also like to point out that we still have De La Rosa in our bullpen as well. I think
he's the
forgotten guy. He's a lefty. He's still young. He has a lot of potential. His arm has always been raved about, and I think he got kind of a bad rap from Ned Yost last year just because he blew a couple of those games in the early parts of the season. I hope that he gets another chance and that in spring training he can kind of build up his confidence again. Can come back and pitch great, and if we get him as a lefty in our bullpen next year, a guy who's actually going to play some innings, I think that's like adding a whole other pitcher to the roster. So
that's
I'd be very excited with that.
About De La Rosa, our source, TC, for the show.
Well, Tom Carter.
TC.
Yeah.
He says that De La Rosa has a lot of gas. So.
That's true, yeah. Well, in any case,
gas, that's for sure.
Before we talk, though, about Kolb as an actuality in our bullpen, I think it's also important to point out a bit about his contract situation. He was traded from Braves to the Brewers, but if he wouldn't have been traded, the Braves would not have offered him arbitration. Now, the Brewers probably are not going to offer him arbitration either, because by the rules in arbitration, as you guys know, and most of you in West Dallas probably know as well, but for the rest of the state, you have to have 80% of your salary from the year before if you are offered arbitration through a team. So you can only cut a player's salary by 20%. In doing that, we would have to pay Kolb something like $2.7 million next season, which isn't going to happen. And so the Brewers are not going to offer him arbitration and are going to hope to convince Dan Kolb to sign here once he becomes a free agent at a much lower rate. So it's not a done deal yet. I know that Dan Kolb's agent is Scott Boros, and there were, of course, it was a bloated market for relievers in this offseason. As we've said before, it was a very small, underachieving free agent class. So the guys who did have some success in the last few years, especially the relievers, seem to have gotten a ton of money with Bobby Howery and Scott Iyer and B.J. Ryan and everybody else who was signed in the last few weeks.
Billy Wagner,
exactly.
So I think if the plan, and people are kind of confused by it, but you've pretty much explained it well, that by December 20th of 2005, if the Brewers do not offer Kolb arbitration, he will not make that $2.7 minimum for the Brewers. Instead, he becomes a free agent then. He could sign with any team, but the advantage from here until December 7th is that we now get to negotiate, because he's an owner, property of the Milwaukee Brewers. We get to negotiate with Kolb and work out a deal with him, whereas if he was still a member of the Braves until they did not offer him arbitration, we could not have started dealing with him and working something out. So I think Kolb, he still has a home in Union Grove, I believe. He wants to come back. He's part of the local wrestling circuit, I know.
That's why, as I say, he's a great wrestling referee. I remember he put Carmine in the claw and actually pinned him for a 3 count in a steel cage as last time we saw him, and then he was traded 2 days later.
Like a day, 2 days later.
Yeah, so we're glad to have that guy back. So, I mean, I think I think he's going to be making more in the range of, from what I understand, and of course this is pure speculation, but in the range of about $1 million is what we'll probably, hopefully, sign him in that range.
Sure.
So that'll be a good move by the Brewers, for sure.
I'd say give him anywhere between $1 million and $1.3 million myself. I do think that his arm would be valuable enough to give him a few extra $100,000, as much as that sounds for everyone who doesn't work for this station, which pays a lot of money for this show. I know it's a lot, but in any case, Dan Kolb is, I think, a quality right-handed arm, and hopefully the Mike Maddox touch can kind of re-resurrect his career again, and Milwaukee will be a place where he can succeed now in the next coming years. And
he's longing for the Max touch. I remember, again, during the All-Star break, he said he just wanted to go home and think about what Mike Maddox taught him
over the
weekend. During the All-Star break, apparently he doesn't remember, but now I get to see him face-to-face and receive the touch. And
yeah.
So I wonder if when that trade was made, how the Braves fan reaction, I don't know if they were like, now the Brewer's going to back for nothing. I think it was more about, you can have him back.
Yeah.
Because he did pitch very poorly for the Braves last year. So, I mean, you know, so hopefully he comes back and rebounds. And
Do you remember when the Brewers lost manager Jerry Royster, when we fired him? I think it was kind of that feeling for the Braves fans with Danny Kolb. Not much success last year in Atlanta.
No.
Danny, I know that you're a fan of the show, living in the area and all. I hope that you interview with us and let us know what your contract situation is becoming, and hopefully next year, as you're in a Brewers uniform, you kind of are celebrating your success with us here on the show. So he probably watches us every Sunday night.
Yeah, so look for an interview with Dan Kolb, hopefully, in our 2006 Brewer Review season. So with that being said, we need to go to our next segment and find out, obviously he's not here right now, but we need to find out, where in the hell is Scott Bartell?
We actually have no idea this time.
So let's go and see if what we can find out. I don't know how this is going to go, but let's go ahead and go to our special segment, Where in the Hell is Scott Bartell? Well, we're back on the set and still no Scotty. We went out with camera crews trying to find out where in the hell Scotty Bartell is, and I had no success. I don't know if you guys, where did you guys go to look for him?
I had looked at Long Wong's. It's one of his favorite watering holes that he goes to, and you know, he drinks 7-Up there. But no, I didn't.
Wet as whistle.
I didn't find him there. I talked to the proprietor, Paul Wong, and he couldn't. He hadn't seen him in at least 20 hours, you said. So,
Chad, did you have any luck?
I wasn't really looking for Scott. I was looking at other things, but Scott, I don't think, was there. I didn't look too hard. I guess we'll call Mark A.
We'll have to call
the station's budget.
Yeah, well,
Mark A.
I actually stopped by Miller Park and looked all around. I checked Bernie's Chalet, no Scott there. It was actually quite cold up there. I did find an empty container of cotton candy, though, with a handle. It was kind of strange.
And some lollipop wrappers.
Some lollipop wrappers, yeah.
But he's still no Scott. So, Scott does have his had that Christmas tag that you gave him, of course, that great Christmas present, the number of the studio here.
Yes.
So if anyone finds him lying, you know, head down on a bar or possibly in a nearby ditch, or in a mall.
He could be at the IHOP eating pancakes,
in a mall.
Too.
He also could be at the North Pole.
He loves pancakes.
Everybody in our audience saw him in his elf costume last week. He might have been taken by Santa, whom he saved, actually.
Taking
him to the North Pole for deliveries in the upcoming week. So
no one's seen him since Christmas. So I know Scott helped save Christmas, and so now I'm hoping someone can help save Scott, because we just don't know where he is, and we want him back on the show next episode. So. Still no Scotty on the set, unfortunately, but hopefully next episode.
Fingers crossed.
I wanted to add that this was our 21st ever episode of the Brew Crew Review. Mm-hmm. I believe it's our 10th to air on Wisconsin on demand, so hopefully we've started to build a little bit of an audience here.
Well,
and we're really looking forward. This will be our last show of 2005, of course, here. But 2006, I think, is going to be a great season. We did actually hammer out, I believe it was 16 or 17 episodes in 2005 alone. So
that's right.
It was quite the season. It took us all the way from, you know, the Brewer locker room to Nashville, Tennessee, to Toronto, Canada.
To Wrigley Field.
And
Cincinnati.
The North Pole.
Detroit.
and everywhere. So, I mean, really, yeah,
we've
it
was been a lot of places and saved Christmas at the same time. So
yes, I think we've been to all the cities where Huey Lewis sang and the Heart of Rock and Roll is still beating.
That's right. That's true.
And if we've missed some, we've got the 2006 season to look forward to. Hopefully, we'll be touring St. Louis, Kansas City,
Minneapolis,
Chicago. Hopefully, some further away. Oh, and additionally, Phoenix, Arizona.
Phoenix, Arizona for spring training is another 2006 highlight for all of you to look forward to.
A little bit of, I don't know if we'll be able to get footage that'll be airable, but hopefully a little bit from Las Vegas as well.
Las Vegas.
Opening day, wow. So we're going to bring you, we're gonna go in search of brewer footage all over the country. And also going to look, then starting in January 2006, to introduce a few new segments, possibly a fan-oriented segment. And also, we're going to continue on with our email segment.
That's right. So
we've ran out of time with all the flurry of trades and the saving of Christmas and stuff to really read too many emails.
Yeah, we did get an interesting one with a hedgehog on it.
Yeah, so thanks for sending in that hedgehog.
And if anyone's shot any large animals like Marty, I don't know if you want to show a picture again, play the music.
Some Davy Crockett music,
But so tune in again for the 2006 season. But before we leave you...
Well, I'd also like to point out one more thing, and since we're talking about the emails here. We've gotten several emails about prospective intern positions with our organization here, with our show. Unfortunately, those have been filled for this year, but starting again in 2006, we'll be reaccepting internship applications.
Second semester.
Second semester credits are available through your local colleges. We've worked this out with several of the local area schools. So just make sure you send us your information.
Send it to Vince at brewcreview.com.
Send pictures, too, with your application.
Be glad to look at your internship applications, and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. So hopefully we can bring you back into the fold for the exciting baseball season
coming
up in 2006.
Got several positions open, of course.
Yes, we do.
That's a good thing. But also, if you have any email questions about the Brewers offseason, anything about how Scott's doing, whatever you want to send us, send those. Chad's in charge of our viewer email. Send those to Chad at brewcreview.com, and we'll answer those hopefully on the next show. Mm-hmm. Okay, so check out our website at brewcreview.com. There's a whole bunch of goodies there. Our fan forums, as Chad mentioned. Also, video downloads. You can check out our episode guide of all 21 of our episodes that started back in the summer of 2004 and have led us up. And we want to try to make the show better. So if you have any suggestions besides, you know, us wearing shoes and different clothes, stuff like that, any other suggestions you want to make for the Brewer Review, send those suggestions over to me as well at craig@brewcreview.com. So, and also a quick shout out and a special happy birthday to the director of tonight's show, our production expert, Mike the Glue Gittins.
That's right.
Notice him in the credits. This production would not be possible without Mike Gittins, and we very, very much appreciate the work that the Glue does for not only the Brewer Review organization, but the Milwaukee Brewers organization as well. Is, like I said, the glue that holds the Milwaukee Brewers together, actually.
He really is a great man, and he doesn't want us to tell everyone how old he is. Let's just say, for the first time ever, it's him living into a third decade. So
yeah,
we don't want to actually name a number. It's kind of confidential.
It's between 29 and 31.
Yeah, between 29 and 31, it ends in a zero. But that's all we're going to
give that away. So happy birthday, Mike. And also,
while we're on birthdays, I also want to wish our fellow colleague Bob Brainerd a happy birthday. It was sometime in 2005.
Happy birthday, Bob.
To continue with this trend and not to make this segment totally ridiculous, I actually want to sincerely extend a happy birthday to our executive producer, Craig Mueller, whose birthday is coming up next week, and we will not be taping. So it's time to take this opportunity and wish you a happy birthday, Craig.
You.
And thanks
Appreciate
again for
it.
All the hard work, executive producer Mueller.
Thank you very much. Looking forward to 2006 Brew Crew season.
Friday at Long Wong's. I don't know if this will air beforehand, but Friday at Long Wong's.
You can go there any Friday, though.
Go there any Friday. Talk to Paul and karaoke with Bob.
Yeah, definitely. And Paul Wong. So anyway, wrap up today's show, we're going to go to a special Lyle Overbay tribute video, and these are all some of our fond memories that the Brewer fans, of course, have shared, and here at the Brewer Review with Lyle over the years, and we're going to wish him the best of luck as a Toronto Blue Jay, and we really appreciate for everything he brought to the organization over the last 2+ years.
It was a short ride. It seems like the Sexton trade was just yesterday, but I think that Lyle gave us a lot of memories, 2 quality years at first base, and we'll miss talking to him.
Yeah, and hopefully, you know, he'll be back around in town sometime, and we'll be able to, you know, catch up on how he's doing.
Also, Lyle Overbay was on the official Brew Crew Review Christmas card list.
Yes,
I hope
was.
He got his Christmas card. We have to send one to Toronto. We need special postage for that, though.
Yeah, that's definitely. True. So wrap up the, let's go to that Lyle Overbay tribute, and you know, and that'll wrap up today's show. So if you remember, everyone back all over Wisconsin, to remember to
stay classy, Wisconsin.
Crazy Brewer fans right here. Tailgating on a Saturday night. We're in the rain. They don't care.
Overbay! Overbay! Overbay!
I waited around and then I run to the door. I can't take anymore. It's not you.